It's nice to see all of you, and it's nice to see for me that a lot of people are here and listening about the security and the DevOps things. And I hope that you feel more energized now, because you got the coffee and ready to listen another talk about the security. Are you? Good? Good, fantastic. Recently, 2 weeks ago, I was presenting security at DevOps Days Oslo. And if I can compare both of DevOps Days, here at least I have calculated at least three talks about the security. In Oslo, we had one Ignite talk. So you can imagine what I could say about the security in 5 minutes. Yeah. Okay, so today I will gonna speak about the containers, and of course I will gonna start a bit about myself. And it's kind of tricky always for me to speak about myself, and it took some time to get three things what could describe me. So I'm cloud security architect, and these three words is all what I'm passionate the most about: the cloud, about the security, and architect. And by architect, I mean like I always work with the DevOps and architects on the field. I don't like to sit in ivory tower, write any type of the paperish recommendations, and then just say to developers or architects, you must follow it. No, my approach is slightly different. I want to be in the team and help them to make security as a culture. And this is where I'm driven for, making security as a culture. So usually you can find me at three places. One of them is stage. Sometimes I'm speaking. Then if I'm not between the teams and between architects and the developers, then I'm on the motorcycle. I guess this is something common between the security. They love extreme things. And yeah, some contacts. Okay. I would like to have some small warning that I will gonna focus only on the containers. I will not touch the orchestration part, because this is another huge area, and I have only 40 minutes. This is some limited time, and I will try to go briefly on the container security. And of course, I always like to take the examples. In 2015, the British guy Ben Hall got the message from the Digital Ocean, which is the public cloud hosting platform, that his account or his solution is closed, since they are getting outgoing traffic, which was really huge and looked like as a DDoS thing. So Ben Hall started to investigate what is happening. And he saw that his Elasticsearch, which was configured and run on the container, on the Docker container, produced a lot of the traffic outside. So basically, someone used his Elasticsearch for DDoSing other resources. And how it was possible? That time, Elasticsearch had one security problem. So basically, Elasticsearch by nature allowed to take the requests, and in these requests you could implement Java code. Even the Elasticsearch company have made some safe filtering, so to filter what kind of the Java code is allowed, they had the gaps. So basically, if your Elasticsearch is open and listens for the request, like, you know, we are pushing the log data and everything else to the Elasticsearch, it's kind of a bit expected situation. Not if it's open for the whole world, but anyhow. So we can send the information to our Elasticsearch. And the next thing was the hackers, what they did, they just checked if the Java works, if they could implement the Java command line in the search, and they just checked the OS. Yeah, it worked. And of course, when they played around and tried to find out what kind of the Java libraries could work, And we found out that the Java library math class was not whitelisted. And through this math class library, we were able to download external HDB bin, I guess, yes, HDB bin. And then just checked, yes, HDB bin runs, and we were able to check with some contents of the files. And of course, we could able to read the password. These guys, they were using this particular vulnerability for the making DDoS requests. Yeah, and if you want to play around with this specific exploit, you can do it already now, because shortly after that, the bad guys, as usual, added this component in the Metasploit. So how many of you are familiar with the Metasploit? Good. Yeah, so this is the framework which contains the payloads and prepared the code for the exploiting systems based on common vulnerabilities. And this was one of the common vulnerabilities specific for the Elasticsearch. Yeah, so here I just played around and set up the host with the vulnerable Elasticsearch, which is basically that Elasticsearch should be older than version 1.4, and try to exploit it. And as you can see, I got the access to command line. Even that security problem is not specific for the Docker, because this is application-oriented security flaw. Ben Howe called it as a first Dockerized security flow, because actually he was running Elasticsearch in the Docker. And based on his comments, he mentioned, like, luckily I was running Elasticsearch in the container, so my container was compromised, not the whole host. But of course, I'm curious, and I always like to see, are there any Docker or container-specific attack vectors. And then I can mention another case, which is for the 1 year younger, and it has happened in 2016 July. A bug bounty hunter was playing around with the Sensis. This is the new hacker platform, so kind of the new hacker platform, similar to the Shodan. So have you played around with the Shodan? Yeah, for others, shortly explain. I will explain. The Shodan is the website where you can look for the devices, for the websites which have open ports. Yeah, so basically, it is searching engine for the open ports, and this is the place where a lot of the security folks finds unprotected IoT devices, unprotected video cameras, and unprotected services. And the Sensis, this is something new, with the same idea, but focusing only on application. So the guy, the bug bounty hunter from India, was playing around with the Sensis, and specifically was looking for the Docker APIs. Because when you're configuring the Docker, you can also establish the API. Current versions of the Docker API are published on the TCP, but internally, but you can expose them publicly. And by default, it was not protected by any authentication. So what he saw, he noticed it that there is one private Docker registry running and fully available. And it turned out that this private registry was for the solution named Wine. Wine is the short form video sharing service, which allows you to share 6 second long video. And this solution had been bought by the Twitter back in 2012, I guess, or 2011. So Twitter is using this Wine. And it turned out that on the address Docker Wine app, there was a fully open private registry, which must be closed. And so he just looked around and found that he can see 80 images, and he can freely download 80 images from that registry. What he did, he took one image which was specifically named www app, I guess, and just run it. And as a result, he was able to set up a replica of the Vine solution on his own local host. As you can see, the address is localhost. And like he mentioned it, that all the credential keys, API keys, everything was also in that container. Cool. So basically, the Vine was compromised just by one guy who was, like, you know, searching, using the search engine, and found that the registry is widely open. Of course, Twitter, together with Vine, they have closed that issue. But recently, I just looked what is happening, and I took the showdown. Each time when the Docker registry is published, it has three common patterns. Based on them, you can recognize that this is the Docker registry. So basically, HTTP header, together with the no sniff and the content length. The answer from the Docker registry always is like 90. So we can see that on the showdown, we can find some already Docker APIs, and maybe who knows how many of them are unauthenticated. And then I took the census. The search was even a bit easier when it comes to the patterns which you need to put. And you immediately can notice that a lot of the Docker registries are available for you and without any authentication. So the people used to publish, set up the Docker, publish it, and don't think about the security. Something similar what we now see in different areas when it comes to the video devices or IoT devices. People just set up, install, and don't care. And the reason is maybe is like, as you can see. I mean, I even didn't touch that IP, but it was interesting. Like, yeah. I guess this is a common reason why we see security issues not only in the Docker but in any other areas. Just people don't, if they don't understand, easiest feeling is to have some feelings about that. Yeah, but if we look on the containers itself, then this is not something new. This is not like what have been flash now last 3 years and like, wow, silver bullet for the microservices and wow, cool, something new what we now are using. History have a tendency to repeat herself, and if you look on the from the historical perspective, then the first container was already created in 1979 in the Unix environment, and this was what it was called CHROOT. How many of you are familiar with the CHROOT? Thanks God, I'm not so old as I thought. Yeah, so I was playing around. I remember my FreeBSD and Linux journey started actually with the CHROOT and escaping from these CHROOT things. 20 years later, FreeBSD introduced the jails, which were basically on the go, having the same concept of the virtualizing the processes. And the main driver of that was that a lot of the companies or the people used FreeBSD as a hosting platform for the hosting the websites or any other solutions for the clients, and they wanted to use the same BSD system for the different clients, and of course how you can isolate them. And this is how jail was introduced. When we faced with the Linux V server, so Oracle also took the idea and have created their own containers, and then we saw OpenVZ, which was even more virtualization, deeper. And then Google, of course, came with their process containers. And then in 2008, actually the first container ideology, like the clean container ideology, what we are facing now, have been introduced. And it was Linux containers, but that project, I guess, yeah, it's still kind of running, but not heavily supported anymore. And then we had the Warden, and then in 2014 we get this let me contain that for you solution, which was also like kind of the containerization, I'm sorry. So yeah, and at the same time we faced with the Docker, which at the beginning was based on LXE solution, and now we're using lib container in the background. But the why, if you look on the history, why the Docker is the most popular? Just because when the Docker was introduced, it came with the environment, with the easy way to deploy, maintain, and work with the containers. And I guess we also jumped in the right time when we started to use these concepts of the microservices and going from the monolithic towards the modular architecture. So yeah, the Docker is something what we, I don't want to call it as a trend, this is like the thing what we are using heavily now. And even the Docker, I like the Docker from the security perspective, because they put a lot of the effort in the security, and they deploying the hundreds actually interesting tools when it comes to the security, and they are doing this with the security in mind. But still, we need to look on the container attack vectors which exists today. And my examples, they will gonna be based on the Ubuntu, and on Ubuntu, Docker is running the latest version of the Docker. But you can, when we will discuss with attack vectors, you think about the containers, no matter is it the Docker or any other solution. So the first thing, when it comes to the container, we should remember that the root in container is a root on the host. Due to Linux shared nature, that like we have one kernel, it means that when you are running the process in the container, if you start the container, when you are landing in the bash of that container, you are as a root. But let's look on the example. So basically, maybe not the best background, but I will try explain in the words. So what I did, I just started the Docker from the image Alpine, which is one of the images what I like to use because of the minimization. Interesting story about the Alpine. The guy who made that image, at the beginning he was creating that for the routers, just to build as small as possible image, and it was like around 4 megabytes. So you can imagine there is no needed packages if we compare even with Ubuntu image. Anyhow, I'm starting the Alpine, and what I'm doing, I just copied the common touch as the back, and then when I'm running this Alpine image, I'm specifically mounting the hosts bin towards a host folder in a container, and trying to remove this touch back. So basically what we can see, of course, what happens from the container inside, we are deleting the file which is on the host. And the common way how you are doing this is you are running your container with one of the users, so you are assigning the user and giving the minimal privileges for that user, and then you are not able to delete anything, especially if it's mapped from the host. You are not able to proceed that. So you have two choices. Either you are running the Docker image with the command option from the console line, or of course nowadays you are adding this in Docker file. But what if your container requires privileged access? What if your container needs to have a root inside of the container for some privileged operations? Then the next common thing is to use user namespaces. And the user namespaces, it's a Linux security feature. What it allows? It allows the root user inside of the namespace. So basically in the container, that user will gonna be the root, but it will be mapped to the unprivileged user on your host. So basically, if you have the user called Marco on the host, that Marco will gonna be as a root on the container, but not outside. In the Docker, this is something what is already implemented by default, because but you need to look on which operating system you are running the Docker. And the first thing, what you will gonna do to enable this, in the Docker, you are taking the daemon JSON and you are adding the user and then remap. I have placed it here the default, because when you are installing the Docker, Docker creates the user with the name Docker map. So if you are specifying here like the default, the Docker will gonna take that user and will run container with that user. Or you can put here any other user, but the thing is that that user should exist. So, okay, so when you are starting the Docker with the user namespace is enabled, you get the solution that definitely even the mapped root directories from the host or the any other directory from the host will not be touchable by the container's user. And another interesting thing, if you will look on the Docker info, you will gonna see that for that container, the default root directory becomes will be located under the varlib Docker and under the ID of that user. Cool. Now we have a running container without the root privileges or with the limited things, but definitely if your application in the container it gets compromised, something bad can happen. I can try to elevate my rights and become as a root. So no new privileges. This is a security configuration which tells that if you are a non-privileged user, I don't care, you stay as a non-privileged user. So it doesn't allow you to execute set uid command for the set uid process, which helps you in the Linux kernel to raise the user uid. And if you look on the example, then this is like the one of the famous examples, which basically elevates the uid to the root level, written in the C and compiled. And so basically, if I run the Docker with the regular user, I see that it has been elevated to the zero, which means the root. But if I add only one small option, like the security option, no new privileges. Cool, fin. I'm staying as a on the 1000. So basically, I'm staying as a non-root. Which means if your application gets compromised and someone was able to put some code in the container and try to elevate the rights of the process under which your application is running, then it simply will not gonna work. Another thing is what is called the seccomp. Basically, the seccomp answers on the question, what can I call inside of the container, inside of the Linux? And as we know that everything is a syscall, and so it means that Linux applications interact with the kernel through the syscalls. And seccomp allows to limit which calls can be called, which can't be. And by default, if you are using specifically the Docker, Docker already limits the dangerous calls. And if you will try to do some dangerous commands, then they simply will not gonna run in the container. But of course, you can customize profiles. You can make the seccomp profile. And the first thing what you need to check again, if it matters on which Linux distribution you are running the Docker, because you need to check in the kernel if this seccomp security feature is enabled in the kernel. And like I said, I'm using the Ubuntu, which is actually running in Amazon, but it's the seccomp is enabled. What I did, I took the simple example and have defined basically with like the commands for this container, basically command chmod chown, you are not allowed to be run. And if you start your Docker with this security option, like, hey, please load seccomp profile on my image, on my container, and I'm trying to run the command, like basically change the permission level on the some file, I will get operation not permitted. So basically, you should be kind of a bit careful when you are defining this list, but I mean, if you having the front-end website which is running in your container, why your container should contain the commands which can do something with your system? I believe in that case, the container should be read-only. Another thing, what is also heavily supported by the Docker is App Armor, which answers on the question, what can my application do? So again, this is the Linux security module, which allows you to restrict the capabilities of the processes, and so basically running on the host operating system. Yeah, so basically you can pass your own policies, and by default it is available in Debian and Ubuntu. And if you look, I just took the example from the Docker. If you look on the Docker documentation, they have also this Nginx example with the profile. It's quite huge profile which defines a lot of the actions what's not allowed to do, is like the touch command, the ping, and so on. So basically that profile was specifically prepared for the Nginx container. Because the biggest trick is to customize this, so you are limiting all the possible rights, but still your application is running. So yeah, and I just loaded, and I got with that security option, App Armor, please Docker Nginx. I'm exposing it, and then I'm trying to run the classical command touch text, and we get the permission denied. If you will try to ping, the ping is also will gonna be like operation is not permitted. And the good thing is you can check how many profiles are available already by default. So basically, if you look in the command status app armor, which is AA status, you will gonna see that I have the 15 profiles preloaded, and some of them are enforced, some of them not. And here this example, which I showed you on the previous slide, called Docker Nginx. And so basically, if I remember correctly, the Docker is heavily working on this, both the seccomp and app armor. They are implementing a lot of new things. For example, if we go back to the seccomp, I mentioned that the Docker is already have done a good work by whitelisting and forbidding some dangerous processes. For example, we have around 300 something calls what we can make towards the Linux. A Docker forbids 40 of them by default, but still we have 270, I guess, which can be the dangerous, and that's why the seccomp is needed. And the same is with App Armor. Even the Docker is providing some profiles, but we have a lot of different applications what we are set up inside of the containers, and we can make them customized. So, and honestly, writing the profile for the App Armor is kind of a big pain. That's why one of the persons who was used to work a lot in this area have created the tool which is called Bane, which helps you to make these profiles really easy. So basically it has a good declarative language, and you can play around and maybe use Bane for the defining profiles. And of course, so now we have protected the container, we have configured what is allowed to be run, what is not allowed. We, even in the case of the compromise, we know that the rights will not be elevated. But in the case what I showed at the beginning with the wine, with the bug bounty hunter mentioned that in the image he found a lot of the secrets, because we used to store the secrets inside of the container. And one of the approach which is suggested by the 12 factor, have you read that article, 12 factors? Yeah. One suggestion was for the developers that you should keep your secrets in environment. Me as a security, sometimes I suggest this for the developers, but I'm saying that it has some of the consequences, because if someone will get inside of your container, for example, it will get also environmental variables. So what kind of the choices do we have? One of the things what we can do is to mount the volume or the data volume where we specifically are storing our contain our keys, and of course just be careful not to upload this in the GitHub later. And another thing what you can do is I promise not to touch orchestration, but in this case the Docker Swarm provides the good thing called Docker Secrets, and we will look on the practical example how it can be used. So basically the keys are stored in the memory. And the another thing which is really nowadays get the full speed of the popularity, and this is what I'm quite often suggesting, especially for the applications landed in the cloud, is to use the key management systems. In the Amazon it is key management system, in the Azure it's a key vault. But the problem with this thing and with this thing is again we are having the chicken and egg problem. Okay, we are storing all the keys in the wallet, but to be able to get an access to the wallet we need to have a key and we need to store it somewhere. And it end up again being in the container. But this is a good, specifically if you have thousands of the environments, or if you don't want to provide the access to the sensitive keys for the developers, or like, you know, for the production environments, then you are just providing the access for your application, which is really good. And of course, if you don't want to be dependent on the cloud solution, HashiCorp have a really nice thing called HashiCorp Vault. I think the HashiCorp for you is familiar from the Terraform. Are you using the Terraform? Someone here, yeah. So this is like the infrastructure as a code. I strongly suggest you, because I love it personally. I love it because, again, this is a kind of independent scripting for me, and I don't care, am I working with Amazon or with the Azure. Both of them are like, I terraform my infrastructure. I stopped to use the Azure ARMS or the CloudFront. Yeah, so basically the HashiCorp releases a lot of interesting tools, and one of them is a vault. And they kind of solve this chicken and egg problem, because what they do, yes, they establish the vault, the wallet, the keys are stored, but they the access is based on also on the key which is stored and protected in the memory, and that key is signed and generated specifically for your container, which is like kind of secure. So if we look on the example with the Dockers, with the Docker secrets, it's kind of easy, especially like if you are using the Docker Swarm, then you are taking your secret, saving it in the wallet, it's saved, and then you are creating the new service, and you are creating it with the secret and your secret wallet for your image, which is like Redis in Alpine. And if you try to execute the bash, for example, and try to get your secret, which will be unencrypted and available for you for usage in the container, which is kind of good if you use the Swarm. Yeah, just summarizing. So I want to give some good advices, and of course verify images. So don't grab the first one from the internet, because it fulfills your needs. You never know what is in that image. Then I really like the approach called reverse uptime, which have been introduced at least the first time when I heard about that terminology was from the Diego Monaco, who is the lead security in the Docker. And that approach is kind of the similar what we are facing today with the continuous integration, continuous development, that we are pushing new releases constantly. Something similar now we need to switch our mind when it comes to the infrastructure. Back in the times, I remember I was really proud when I had the FreeBSD router, which had the uptime around like, you know, 3 years, three and five years, and it was running on the diskette, if you remember what was. Yeah, and so the reverse uptime approach is if your container is running more than 3 days, it's time to redeploy it. It's too old. And this is something, by the way, if you are working with the virtual machines in the cloud, I had a case with the Azure when my virtual machine was running around 1 year with the 1 year uptime. And I started to get some strange issues, and Azure support told me like, hey, you know what you need that all the time running, but this is not nowadays a good practice what you have is for the uptime, even you are applying all the patches and so on. If you need to apply changes, redeploy it. Just delete it, throw it away, and put the new image. This will also help you in the security terms. If someone have compromised your application, you have redeployed because you just switched to the new image, and that's all. The hacker lost their shell. So of course, automated builds check the Docker file, and when you are taking the images and everything, pull by digest. Don't rely on the name. Maybe it was compromised, and audit images. And in the case if you feel that something strange is happening with your container, use the Docker diff, which will gonna show you some changes, what has happened. And really good tool in terms of the investigating of making some forensic if you have been compromised. And yeah, the Docker content trust, if you go deeper in the Docker, and notary is something what you should spend some time and read and dig in. Because basically, it will allow you to publish and manage trusted collections of the content. And then the scanning tools, Docker Bench. Should I say that it's kind of old, because it's 2 years already, and nowadays, what is older than 1 year is old. But it's a good security tool, which gives you advices about the best practices. It checks your image container and says what is wrong. And like I said, but use minimal images like Alpine, because if you take, for example, the Ubuntu image, you already by default have around 150 packages, I guess, which you need to maintain. And if you will take any of these scanning tools and will scan that image, I bet you will find at least 20 vulnerabilities there already by default. And I mean, this is a reason why I would better spend more time and adding the libraries what I need in the minimized image than we'll do it vice versa by cleaning. So to summarize my talk, I would again ask the question, is container secure? Yes, it's secure-ish. As much as your best practice. And of course, if you are taking the application, it's another story. And we had some talks today focusing on the things what I used to speak a lot with the developers, how we need to bring the security in the application. So that's why I prefer to say the secure-ish. And like I said, that it's a good thing that the Docker is so focused on the security. And they have really nice tools, which maybe not directly connected to the security, but helps to establish best practices of the continuous integration, continuous development, like InfraKit, LinuxKit, RunC. I suggest to look on them, and especially like the LinuxKit, I guess, InfraKit was the thing what helps you to establish this reverse uptime strategy. And of course, I suggest to proceed with Catecode. Some of one or two examples I took from the Catecode, which is a learning platform for free, where prepared a lot of the scenarios which you can play around. Because, for example, don't play with your even the don't play with the production number, don't play with the test environment dockers when it comes to the user namespaces, because you should be careful when you are switching it on, switching it off. Better take the Catecode. They have prepared the interfaces, and you can and also the scenarios, and that Elasticsearch scenario is available there, because with Catecode, which is like where the story becomes funny, have been created by Ben Howe, who have been compromised with this Elasticsearch. So he went deeply in the Docker security, and he ended up with the providing educational platforms. And it's for free, and it's really enjoyable. So you can take different topics. It's not only about the security, it's also about how the Docker should be used, how HashiCorp can be installed, and so on, so on. The good point, starting point, is Diego Monaco, who is the sec lead of the Docker. He have really good thoughts and talks about the containerization Docker security. And the thing that I always say to the developers and architects, practice, fail, repeat. Practice, fail, repeat. And this will gonna help you a lot. And the slides, in case if you would like to have the slides are available on my GitHub. So, and I'm open for the questions, and I hope that you have enjoyed, and thanks for having me on the stage.